Okay, well, thank you all for being here today. We are the Heart of Texas chapter of Sisters in Crime International. Just so you know who we are, Sisters in Crime International is in their mission is to promote the ongoing advancement, recognition, and professional development of women crime writers. Writers, readers, women, and men who enjoy mysteries are welcome to join our very active chapter, which is kind of fun. So thank you for being here today. And now on to our speaker. Okay, today we have professional cover artist, Rebecca Byrd, author. Rebecca Byrd has been an independent book cover designer for over 24 years. Prior to creating her own company, Rebecca worked at Holt, Reinhardt, and Winston Publishing, where she was a senior designer in their marketing department. Before joining that firm, she was a cover designer at Morgan Printing and Ginny's One Touch Point in Austin. Rebecca's awards include the Association of Women in Communications Clarion Award and a first place award for the Holt Health textbook cover in the New York Book Show. A classically trained artist, Rebecca paints and enjoys the visual arts. I bet you do, because you're really good at it. Book design is her dream job, helping authors bring their books to life. So without further ado, again, thank you all so much for coming today. There are snacks and drinks and cookies in the back if you need to wet your whistle. Have a good one. Rebecca, here you go.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Can't hear her.
Can you hear me now?
Vaguely. No. No, can't hear her.
Hey, Tom, can you hear us okay?
I can hear you, Kathy, but not her.
Okay, she's not talking yet, so that's okay.
This is Rebecca. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Excellent.
No.
She's only said one sentence.
It's hard to see her up there.
It's because I'm so tall. Well, thank you for having me today. We're going to talk about book covers and things that I think authors should know about how to do a book cover. Oh, things are moving. One moment, technical difficulties. Mm-mm. Well, it was on. And we'll go next.
Let's stop for just a second. I'm going to come back to it.
Okay.
Yep, there we go.
How did you do that?
I don't know. Okay, here we go. We're going to go back into it.
Yes, yes.
Screen share. Here we go. Share. Presentation. Okay. There we go. And I'm just using these.
Oh, okay. Here's the first cover. Can anybody tell me what's wrong with it?
It's a shark.
There you go. Okay, so. These are, I'm actually going to show you some covers of classic books that designers or other people, I can't speak about who, have put together. This actually is good that it has only one typeface on it. Here's Moby Dick, and it looks really good. It uses only one font, and that a font is a typeface. So it uses only one And everything on the cover is just in different point sizes so that you know what to read first. The title is the biggest thing, and it's done in a style that it looks like old cartography to me. This book was published in 1851, so it kind of takes on that. It has the red kind of talks about blood. I mean, you kind of get that it's a war going on. Here's another one that had a really major wrong cover. So what is right about the one to the right? It's in pink. I mean, that's the first thing I saw. And that in pink means innocence and love. So you can tell it's a love story by that. The font and the image are appropriate for the Georgian era. It was published in 1813 for the first time. And you can see the colors are very muted. Okay, here's another one. The Legend of Sleepy Hollow. The one on the right is obviously, these are from, you know, Amazon. These are where I went and got these book covers. The ones on the right. And you can tell that it's a Gothic cover because it's kind of spooky and dark. It doesn't speak about the era. It was written in 1790, but it has a haunting atmosphere. So the trees tell us about the hollow where most things happen there.
Now, go ahead and tell us what's wrong with the one that isn't good.
Okay, so I've had a request to talk about the one that isn't good. The only thing good about it is it uses one typeface instead of a whole bunch, but the image is really very busy, or what I call busy. There's too much going on. You can't see. The type is as big as the lady's face. I can't tell you how this image met with the requirements for this book. But there are a lot of places to get your books done online, Fiverr or whatever, for people that don't know our classics, our American classics. So you're going to get people that have never read the book and never heard of the book. So just be sure that you're checking in with them. This one is All Quiet on the Western Front. And this is the wrong Western Front. Okay. These are real book covers, sadly. Okay, so the one that's the top middle is actually the first edition of this book. And the type font on it is very German to me. I used to be a typesetter. In fact, we used to call this typeface Frankfurter. So it was translated for the first time in 1929, and my pointer's not working, but the far right, All Quiet on the Western Front, the top Carol Merrill. Okay, so the top one, you'll recognize that type as being something from the 20s or 30s, if you're looking at, you know, this, and this is a way for you to talk about how your book, what's going on in your story without showing an image, is by using a typeface from that time. The one on the bottom right is a way to show if it's a historical image. One of the resources that I listed on the FYI page is the loc.gov website, where you can get the Library of Congress photos for nothing to use on your cover if you like. And I would say it speaks about the time and everything. The one to the left that's blue, I had a problem with. Here's why. I can't tell when it's from. To me, that looks like a Civil War image. I mean, if I'm just glancing as I go scrolling through, it's not the best image, you know, just what is it? I mean, it could be the Civil War at first glance. And in the Civil War, they had these things called chevaux de frise, which was a group of pointy thingies that used to stick out so that the cavalry couldn't get through. So that those pointy thingies sort of remind me of that. There's a horse, and then there's one dude, and there's a bunch of dead people. And so that looks like a Civil War image. I wouldn't use that on this book. Okay, so what makes a good book cover? It's meeting your genre's expectations. So you have to know what your genre is. Is it fiction or nonfiction? And then you can go, and this is great on Amazon. You can go on Amazon and do a search for the bestsellers and see what they're doing, what the bestsellers are doing, to find the colors that you might intrigue your readers with. So you want to get the right colors, the right fonts, minimal images, and your branding. So if you're doing fiction, your mysteries, romance, historical fiction, sci-fi, and nonfiction, memoir, how-to books, biographies, cookbooks, can crime fit into either fiction or nonfiction? Sure. They're all out there, the nonfiction ones too. So you'll want to research books that are selling to see what they look like. And just a tip is that sometimes the beautiful covers are not what sells. You must put yourself in your reader's place to get ideas of what they're looking for. And these are how I think you can get started. And we're going to go through each one of these with suggestions. But to go through it quickly, if anybody has boards on Pinterest, you can search for book covers and save them there. You want to look at everything, not just your genre, but everything, and save what you can into a folder or make a screenshot. Oh, I said I'm notorious for having things saved on my phone. I mean, I have to go back, look them up. Make printouts. They'll be fun to revisit when you put your mock-up together or when you want to share your ideas with the designer or with the person who's going to help you with the cover. So look for the inspiration. Choose your book design software. Check your cover dimensions. Choose your images. Choose your colors. Choose your fonts and create a mock-up and test your ideas. So here are some places that I looked for covers, although Reddit has covers and you can just look for covers online and you just get tons of them. Search for other covers that inspire your idea, something in your genre ideally, and however it conveys the message, kind of make note of that if you really like that way. Save the ones you'd like to share with links, printouts, and screenshots. Choose your design software. Okay, I found these when I was getting ready for today. These are really made for authors. So the only ones that I've actually used are Adobe InDesign and Photoshop. That's what I use. There's an article on the FYI sheet that talks more about these if you're interested in doing that. Okay, so I said that, I use Adobe InDesign and Photoshop on every cover, and it costs about $60 a month to use it because it's all cloud-based and you have to connect to the cloud. Choose your book dimensions. Books can be any dimension that you want. It's more awkward when you upload them to something like Amazon because they kind of go with the vertical. Choose your trim size is the same as dimensions. Check with who will be printing your book or who will publish it. Look at the bestsellers in your genre and see what size they are, or take your little ruler to the bookstore and measure it. And it's width by height. That's the way books are measured. Paintings are measured height by width, so it's important to kind of know. The colors are I put a chart here on the paper because these are basic truths and you can get away with this. I mean, this is a good place to start. I always find I break the rules. Instead of having just these colors, I have something like burgundy or teal or something that's kind of rides the middle, you know. But the purpose of this chart is that once you find the covers that interest you, how do these match up? Does it have, you know, pink or sensitive, whatever? Does it match the mood of the covers that you found that you like? And this is about fonts. And I'm sure most of you know this, but I thought it was important to put on here since it's really big on covers. Is there are two basic font styles for books, serif and sans serif. And serif are the little handily thingies that are hanging off of them, okay? But other fonts are used too. Calligraphy, like we saw on the German book, handwriting, like we saw Jane Austen's name at the top, and handwriting, and scripts. So the tip is to use only one or two fonts per cover, and use the same two fonts on the inside so that it ties it all together. More book covers. The cover should tell us enough about the book for us to be interested. The genre, fiction or nonfiction, the image should pull us in. The color and type are how to set the mood. So here's how to begin. Okay, these are all crime books that I got from Amazon. So they were all new to me. These are not my covers are at the end. Okay, so the first one on the top left, Curious Toys, it has 1915 type in it. It's just old type. So you can see that it's got a roller coaster and it's about an amusement park. So I had to look it up because I don't know what these books are about, but in order to see how close I was, I had to look. And so this book is about the killer using the attractions in the amusement park to get his victims. So knowing that it's a crime book, knowing that it says a novel is fiction, then that pretty much tells me there's going to be crime and death and that sort of thing. The one in the center, it's called Godless, and truly, I had no idea what this was about when I saw it, but it is modern. You can tell that it's modern day by the type. And I also had a question about the author's name, SLMN, and I had to look that up because that turns out to be two authors instead of one. It's a book about tribal. And one of the authors apparently had lived some of this horrendous, I guess everybody was dying. And it's a thriller and it's about revenge. Okay, 40 Elephants is a beautiful cover. It's the colors that most females would like. And it is about females. It's inspired by the true story of Alice Diamond and the 40 Elephants, the first all-female gang of London. That is also on the cover. So you can have a long subtitle as long as it's not as big as your title. This tells us that it was done in the 20s. You can tell by her outfit. You can tell by the type. It's really interesting that the red lipstick and her name at the bottom are the same color. You can tell it's in London because it's got this very ghosted image of the Tower of Big Ben. So historical fonts that speak about the time and place and culture, that is a good way to pull your people in. Large titles and small type in sans serif fonts speak to the emphasis and hierarchy of importance. So let's just look at the swamp. It looks like a swamp to me. It's green and grows like a swamp. It has drippy type like a swamp. And it's about government. That's what we get. It says a Levi Yoder thriller, which must be their character. And M.A. Rothman is the author, but it is not bigger than the type, The Swamp. So this is on Amazon. It's somebody that apparently has more than one in a series. Okay, Autopsy. Doesn't that type look like Autopsy? It's got a big slice through the middle of it. And her name is at the top, and it's in white. Just note all the white type. Okay, Dean Koontz, everybody kind of has heard his name. I didn't have any idea what that book was about, so I had to look it up. It's a psychological thriller, The Other Emily. It's about two women, and one of them gets lost. But I don't understand. If your name is Dean Koontz, you can have your name interacting with all of the background. Otherwise, I find that that's hard to read. But I wanted to say one thing about color, is that all of these have sans serif type, and the color white comes out towards you, and everything dark recedes in the background. So if you want to catch somebody's attention and you're going to have a dark crime cover, white or a light color would be really how to catch their attention. Three more covers. So Wilder, which I thought was a really beautiful cover. The colors are really beautiful, but I didn't know what Wilder Girls meant. Did that mean that their last name was Wilder? I didn't know. I still don't know until I read the book, which I don't think is a good idea for books, but it's a book about, it's kind of like Lord of the Flies for girls in an all-girls school. So it sounds to me like they do things that they wouldn't write home about. The Pale Face Lie is a true story, and it is about a boy who overcomes the abuse of a parent. But the handwriting makes it more desperate for some reason. Okay, and it's all one typeface. The Operator, I really just thought that was the cutest cover, but it's really a crime novel, and it's you can tell what era it's from. It's from the 50s. You can look at that wallpaper and imagine the phone on the wall in the kitchen. Okay, tips to remember when you're designing your front cover. When you're scrolling through and you're looking for something on Amazon, you only have a second to get somebody's attention. So your book cover is going to be about the size of a postage stamp. So use the type wisely. Be sure it doesn't get in the way of the image, of the title, and the author name. It should all work together, so the story comes alive to the reader. Don't put images on the cover that don't appear in the book. Author name on cover, wherever you want it. I used to think they could only go at the top or the bottom, but they can go wherever you want it, as long as the title is the largest and most prominent thing, unless your name is the reason people are buying the book. Let's talk about the back cover. So we looked at the front of Autopsy a few minutes ago, and the image goes from the front to the back. And you'll see that in lots of books. It looks good to do that if there's room for you to put your type and leave room for your picture. The barcode goes on the back, you knew that. The barcode, I don't know if people know how to read a barcode. That one says 5/17/99. The 5 means the US dollars, and the 17.99 is the price. So even though it has it written under there, most barcodes don't. That's how you know how much it is. I'm going to show you what other barcodes look like that don't have a price in a minute. Okay. You can do about the author on the back cover. You can do it inside, or you can do it in both places. You can use your publishing name and website. If you are publishing your book, if you're self-publishing, you can have your own logo with your own name and put that out there as a way of people knowing who you are. This particular book has credits on the back cover. I don't often do that. The credits on the back cover, I sometimes put on the copyright page. Repeat the title somewhere and put the genre on the back, because every book has a 50-50 chance of being on its back when it's laying around. So you want to advertise yourself with the back as well as the front. Okay, do's and don'ts. Choose the image that relates to your story. Let the designer read the manuscript or synopsis. Check out other covers in your genre. Make sure your type is legible. Make a mock-up and then reduce it. I used to do that on the copier to see how big the type was. Allow a designer to put it together if you can, and be open to their opinion, or hire a team. Make it easier for someone else to keep up with your deadlines. Don'ts. Don't make the cover so busy with image that you can't see the type. Don't misrepresent your story by putting something interesting on the cover that isn't in the book. And don't insult the reader. And I got this, there's a TED Talk on the FYI page that is really very good. And he talks about the apple. So don't put an apple on your cover and then put the word apple under it. Just put the apple or the word, because people are very smart. So you don't have to put by your name on the cover. It can go on the copyright page at the top where it should say the title of your book, by your name, copyright 2022. Just your name needs to go as the author on the front. Okay, so I included this for people who are not knowledgeable about the little acronyms that go in design. The font is the typeface. Graphic is any image. Trim size is the size of your book. RGB is for digital files and Kindle, that sort of thing. CMYK is for printed books. Pixels is a way of measuring graphics. So if you upload your front cover to Amazon, they ask you to have the longest side of your cover on the screen should be at least 1,000 pixels. DPI is dots per inch, and mock-up is the prototype of your cover. This is for people who want to do their own cover and scan their own images. Photos should scan at 300 and RGB. Save your photos in JPEG format, because that saves the most information. Black and white line art should scan at 600 or 1200. And phone camera photos can be used if you have your phone set on the highest resolution. Let's see. So we've looked primarily at technical aspects of covers. There's a whole nother side of design that involves imaginary grids of thirds and color theory and using only an odd number, like three, combined images for a cover. So here are a few of mine. I don't have a lot of crime, but I have a lot of fiction. So, well, I think Candy Bar is, does anybody remember Jack Ruby? He was involved with Candy Bar, and she was Juanita Dale Slusher out of, I think, Fort Worth. So this cover has, it's not just about her. And when I did it, I added the three little black and white images coming off of her leg. So it's really one big image, but the three images add to that. Enlightened Police Questioning and Enlightened Policing are actually textbooks that I did for Mr. Seibel, who he was the law enforcement chair and a former Chicago police violent crimes investigator. So I did covers for him until he retired. Deadly Reunion was not one of my favorite covers, but this is what the author asked for. It was a Texas courthouse that she wanted, and with skulls. These are all one author, and it's a series, but they look kind of different. He has his own, the author has his own way of asking for things. So I did it just his way. The representative, he wanted to look like an album cover and a punk album cover. And it has the Texas Capitol on it. He's very involved in Texas politics. So the district manager is about Texas politics again. And the Water Lord is also like the third in a series. This is a little bit about how authors ask for things and designers try to deliver it. So this particular author wanted a lady on a horse jumping over a fence with a red kerchief on. She had very specific requests, which I couldn't do unless we did a photo shoot. But the budget didn't allow that. So I zoomed in on the male, on the female character and her black horse. So on the left, this horse, this is just a royalty-free photograph from one of the sites that I listed. And this is the cover of the book. So I turned the horse completely black and I put a plaid shirt on the young lady. And that's how I met her expectations. I wouldn't have used black type for the cover, except that the author said that her name was Raven and she had to have black type because that was her name. So you can have whatever you want because it's your book, and that's what I like to deliver. This is the same author. The top on the left was what she requested for this book. The only thing about this cover that didn't fly was I could not make that dress strapless, not if I wanted to. I just couldn't. There are, her earrings is a separate photo. The background is a separate photo. Her engagement ring is a separate photo. And I put it all together, but unless I could make her dress strapless and gossamer, I couldn't sell that cover. So we went back to the main character, and his name is Sin. So this is how we got to that. There are three photographs combined to make the cover in the middle. And the ducks were all we kept out of that one, and then I put them in a different link. They didn't mind. And so I took him out of his background and put him in there. And the type, I put Raven's Woman up there next to Wicked as Sin, so you could see the type goes together. They kind of touch, they kind of make a logo. The author's name is the same on both of the books. Okay, so here's a book where the young lady came to me with this cover and said, I really need a better cover because I can't sell my book. So this is what we came up with. And she wrote three books in this series.
Which one's which?
The one on the left is the first cover that she didn't like. And the one on the right is the one that we came up with. It's a really fun book. Oops, I skipped a screen. This is her series, and what I could do to help her is help her develop her logo for her press. She wanted a dragon. Help her, she had bookmarks. These are bookmarks that you can leave when you have a book signing. And that's just a poster for her book signing. The black and white chain in the middle is actually used on the inside of her book and some on the outside, but mostly as a header on the inside of the book. So these books all have a consistent feel to them. These are some other, this one is not a fiction book, Lonnie Dillard, An Irregular Life. The color is just really vibrant. And it has the author on the front cover, so he doesn't appear on the back cover. And he's, it was published by someone who knew him. Skylark was a book about 1920s, which this book doesn't say anything about that, the cover, but it was about overcoming being an orphan in the 1920s in America. So the bird has a pearl in her mouth. Armand's Folly is just one of my favorite covers. It's a dark mystery in the Gothic tradition. And Comanche Trace is by David Bowles. And I was able to help him out with this cover. He is on the back and he's an Austin writer. So he has several in his series. This is the FYI page. This is all about yours truly. Yes, ma'am. It has a TED. This is the title to a TED.com, a TED talk by Chip Kidd. Chip Kidd is the senior designer at Knopf Publishing in New York City. So there, it's very silly and informative at the same time. The author's assistant is, I work with them an awful lot. They hire me to do book covers when they do manuscripts. The articles that I found helpful are listed below. You can hire a designer on Reezy, Fiverr. There's just lots of places that you can get help. If you have design experience, I hope some of these tips you can use. If you don't, then allow a designer to help you produce a cover, and covers start at about $400. And there are ways you can develop branding. And that is what I had to tell you. Yes, ma'am, questions?
When you say that they start at about $400, is that when you're hiring someone like a designer like yourself, or is that when you're just doing all the work yourself?
No, that you can hire me for $400. And then it depends on how much information and homework you've done in the front end and how I can help you in this end. You know? Okay. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So, Raven, you said you would not have done that in black. What color would you have done it in?
I would have done it in gold. And I would have, there's a lot of technical things that you can do to make that type pop up and look embossed. I would have given it something to break it away from the horse so that it was the first thing you saw. Anybody else have questions? Yes, ma'am?
I have a couple questions. First, I was going to ask you about how you go about finding good fonts. And secondly, I was going to ask if you could talk a little bit about if there are certain tropes that you see on certain genre book covers, like certain things that you see on a mystery book cover versus a romance or science fiction kind of.
Okay. I do all genres of books. I haven't been able to tell, but been able to give you. Like you need to have a shoe on crime, right? It depends on the story because the story is where you get the information. I read almost every book that I can get my hands on. I read manuscripts that I don't even end up doing the book cover. So I would say something in your story, let's say if you're writing a romance novel and you have this really buff dude in the bar, I would put him on the cover. You know, something that would the people, I mean, like, romance tend to have people on the cover, you know, and crime always has more of a mysterious look, you know, they're darker, you know, like, what's going on, I can't tell, you know. And then fonts. I'm a Mac, and Adobe offers us a whole bunch of fonts in the cloud, and they don't look anything like the fonts that I have known about my entire career, that you can go online to font.com and download a font for free and put it into your computer, and it, your computer will see it whenever you use it. It doesn't work that way anymore. You have to buy the font, and you have to prove that you have the font, that you have permission to use it before Adobe will let you add it to your system. So I feel hamstrung by this because I had so many fonts before. But I look for fonts that have a certain feeling. So if I were going to do something with handwriting, I would go in and look at all the handwriting fonts, and there are places you can find them online. I don't think that PCs have the same restrictions. I just know that Adobe does. So if you use InDesign or Photoshop or Illustrator, you have to kind of run the gauntlet before you can use something that you just really fall in love with, or you can go through their fonts and find something so similar. I can't remember the name of the website right now, but if you have a JPEG of a typeface that you like and you copy it over into a box on this website, it will, I think it's called What the Font. Okay. What the Font will do, it'll tell you what is similar to that. And that'll help you. Okay. Yes, ma'am?
Why did you say you prefer the JPEG like to a PNG?
A PNG, if I have my formats right, a JPEG holds more information, especially for print. So you can change, you can go into, you can take any format into Photoshop and change it from a JPEG to a PNG or to an EPS or whatever format you want to have. But JPEGs are easier and cross-platform, and PNGs do not have enough information in them. The pictures aren't big enough. There's not enough resolution. Did that answer your question at all? Mm-hmm. Okay. Yes, ma'am.
What's Google timeline from saying, hi, I want to cover art to here it is, uploaded, what's the time frame?
It can go really fast, like 2 weeks at the fastest, okay? Or it can be 6 months. Or recently, I do the inside of books too. So I've had a book that's 500 pages and also one that's 800 pages. So I couldn't say I would ever do that in 2 weeks. So it depends on the inside, because what happens when you guys make your cover and you're gonna have a print paperback version and you upload the inside to like Amazon, what they do is they make available for you a template that you can do your cover. So you don't get that template that tells you how thick your spine is going to be until the very end. And then it's like, hurry up, you know. That's the way I find it is. So it can go very fast, it depends on how big your book is. If you wanted personalized art, then it depends on what you're looking for. If you guys, there's a lot of really cool art on one of the things that I did on the image page. I think it's called Divergent Art or something like that. So Deviant Art. Those people will sell you crazy, beautiful images. And you can use those, and that makes everything go faster. So I would say 2 weeks to 3 months, depending on if the art's ready or if, you know, you want to approve what's been done.
Is the first tip like emailing you like description of what you have in your mind of what the cover would look like? Okay.
Yes, because the writer's vision is really important. It's really important. Any more questions? Yes, ma'am.
So what I hear you saying, kind of back to the beginning of your presentation, which thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
Is that the title and the author name are the ones that should be the largest on the page online, the print wise?
I would say yes.
Okay. And what are your thoughts about a lot of our folks have different kinds of books that they are writing. Some write cozies, some write thrillers, some write good old Texas ones, traditional, I should say. So depending on the genre also makes a big difference on who, what your visuals are. For example, a lot of the cozies don't even use real people. They use a graphic kind of thing. It's almost cartoony. And then the thrillers, of course, are very, very dark, generally speaking. It just screams suspense to you. So even within the mystery genre, there are different things that you need to watch out for. Maureen was asking you about some of the tropes that you see for different genres. What might those be?
Can you define tropes for me?
Sure. For example, cozies usually have, like I said, almost a cartoon background. Not real, generally speaking, the general. Not a real farm background, if it's a rural type of thing. It's more of a cartoon lawn graphic. It'll generally have an animal of some sort on it. People love cats. First series, it's got a cat on the cover, and they love her books just because they have a cat there, or they have dogs on them, or something like that. A lot of the cozies are also related to some sort of craft. One of our members, David Chambron, is a quilter, and so quilts show up on his covers. And people right off the bat know that this is going to be a quilting mystery. So those play tropes. More serious things like if it's a thriller, might be a lot of blood on it. Or a suspense like that. You showed quite a few copies that looked like they were thriller book covers. And so folks need to be aware of the type of mystery you're writing, right?
Yes, that's correct, I would say.
Yeah. But can you show again some of those suspense ones that you get up? They were really cool.
These?
Those.
Okay.
The girl who lives actually is the one that looks the least like a thriller, and it is a thriller. That almost looks like, you know.
I would say that is a spooky book. I mean, I have a daughter, and I'm sorry that, you know, I mean, this looks like the girl who lived, and it's just kind of the mist, the fog, that just kind of, she's running into the fog. That is, you know, kind of spooky.
Okay, I'm looking at it from back here. So.
Oh, I beg your pardon.
We have another question that popped up just now.
Okay.
Mary asks, did you say that the inside font should match the cover font?
Well, that's a good question. I would use one of the fonts on the cover and the inside when you're designing the type. And you could use it as your chapter head, or you could use it, you know, in the back where it says about the author, you could use it like that. It's usually the boldest font that you can use, that you used on the cover. You would use it in small places on the inside. It just keeps the same continuity. Any other questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Now, folks, first of all, there's cookies and snacks over here, and we'd like to talk with you about what you're doing in your writing stuff. So don't just jump up and leave. We've got some time here. But afterwards, we're going to go to a place called Loopy Tortillas. You get out on 2244, is that what that is? 2244, and as if you're going to 360, go under 360, and it's the first right after you go under 360. You'll turn into a shopping center. It's at the far right-hand side of the shopping center. And they have really good margaritas. We would love to have you join us. So thank you, Rebecca. Thank you for coming out. You nailed it, man. Well done. You're welcome. Come on up. Let's talk about who wants to run from the board.
Thank you all for being here. I'm going to sign off. Does anybody else have any questions or anything before we go? I'm going to go ahead and sign off. Thank you so much for coming. Okay. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.